All right. Hey, it's Lewis here with Ropeadope TV, live from East Philadelphia. We are blessed once again this week. We've had Christian Scott, Terrace Martin, Matt Cappy, and now an extra special guest, Mr. Spanky McCurdy. Welcome.
What's the deal? Happy to be here. What's up? What's up?
So we start off everything with how we met. And here's where I don't remember. How did this happen? I remember.
Well, first of all, I remember having a conversation with my big brother, Little John Roberts, and he said, listen, you need to hook up with Ropeadope. That's what you need to do. And I was like, all right, cool.
That's beautiful.
That's how it started.
Good. So that's the reason that I start with how we met. The reason we even do that is because there's this web of connection that we end up following. In one of the episodes, we talked about Atlanta Records, the band The Four Corners. We talked about Dallas and the folks down there, RC. Talked about Terrace Martin and Spud Seawright and their friendship that connects the Dallas and the LA scene, Kirk Franklin, etc. And here it is again. So John Roberts is from Philly, right?
He's from Philly. He's now in ATL, so you know, that's another connection. Even stretching, well, from Atlanta even to Houston or Dallas, like wherever they are, we're sputting.
Sputs in Dallas.
Dallas.
And sometimes LA. Sometimes Omaha.
Yeah, it's like it's like a, you know, a chain. Everybody's connected.
Yeah.
Some way, somehow.
Well, it's so funny because people from the outside are looking at me, they're like, well, how do you find all these connections? And like, or how do you make all these connections? Like, I don't make these connections. I go and I meet a couple people and it turns out that you all know each other.
Yeah.
So there's, and the reason why it's interesting to me is because the business world works in a compartmentalized fashion, but the real world works through connection.
Exactly.
And you guys all have this network. And now what's happening in business is that because of the internet, there are new networks being formed and so all this division is being taken right out.
Exactly.
And people who care about the same things are becoming connected to each other.
Yep.
And so it's so great that
that's
it turns out that it's Little John Roberts, because that's just one of those. And it's funny because I've never met him.
Wow, that's crazy.
We've emailed back and forth a few times. Everybody speaks about Lil John Roberts and, of course, the Philly-Atlanta connection. But I'm really happy for you to remind me that's how that came about.
Yes.
And then we got together. We had some barbecue.
Mm-hmm. Amazing barbecue. A little bit of whiskey.
And cool. So you're working on a record.
Absolutely. Been working
for
quite some time now. And it's coming. It's like a meteor. It's just coming. It's gonna hit. Boom. But I have some very, very good friends of mine: Aliyah Nyambi, Larry Lambert. Just a couple good friends. Not a whole bunch of people, but just a nice, small, tight unit. A unit that you'll hear on my album, and you'll also hear when I'm rocking out live. So
nice. Can we talk a little bit about your history and like? You grew up in Philly.
Grew up in Philly, born and raised.
What part?
Philly. Nah, I grew up in way uptown in the Island East section.
Nice.
Philadelphia, and then been playing since I was about 2 or 3. You know, a baby, and then
playing drums since you were 2 or 3.
Playing drums, yep.
Cool.
Met Little John when I was about 7 or 8. Yep, and you know. Started sitting under him and getting lessons and, you know, getting better and better. And just the Philly scene with when Neo Soul came in, you know, and it's certain artists that were out, like Aries and Music Soul Child, Joe Scott, so many different artists. And, you know, like the work picked up a whole lot and everything just went from there.
So. Now, how old were you when the Five Spot was open and when the whole
when the Five Spot era was going on, I was kind of sneaking in. I was
okay. That's what I was gonna.
Yeah, I was like 17.
Were you there? Okay,
16, 17. At one point, and then you know, after that, you know,
I was picturing you as like at 5. At that point.
No.
Sorry, bro.
Like when it was when it was really, really happening, I couldn't even like get in. Like, I mean, it was a couple times I tried. I was like maybe 16, 17. I couldn't get out of the house much. You know, I was a church boy. I couldn't.
Gotcha.
So, you know, like 10, 11, me downtown, no. I'm home. So, right, right. But I would sneak. We would sneak through the back door because they had a one entrance you would go in, and then some would come out the back door entrance. Like they would, you know, just leave it open. And all of my friends, for like just years, we would just go through the back door.
Nice.
Yeah, nice.
These are the stories.
So watching, you know, Questlove for those years, it was just like, wow. And then eventually me and my friends started playing in there. We just had to get there like 8:30.
Right, know. To do the early thing?
Right.
So Amir, Questlove, mm-hmm. What, I mean, we all talk about stuff and we say like, these are the golden years and this is what happened. So if you're there, what was his presence? Like, I mean, as a player, or as like a personality or person, it seems to me that he's mystical in his presentation or the way you see him. But like, what is it about him?
It's, you have to take what you can take from him. You know, like he's not the most social person, so it's like, it's not like I was seeing him. Oh my God, hey, he's like, oh yeah, cool man. You know, come down to the studio. You know, it wasn't like that, and I wasn't necessarily like looking for that, but. Every time I would see him, I would tell him, listen, you are a legend. I love you and respect you. Thank you for, you know, being you. Thank God for your gift. And I've been telling him that over the years. Like, now today, we're, you know, much closer and stuff. So, for me, it was just like a musical thing. Just being able to see him and watch what he's doing. Like, listening, like, wow, okay, wow. That was enough right there. Yeah, I don't need you to say his anything. Yeah, just his playing
gotcha.
Alone.
Gotcha.
You know, because then him, his presence. You know, he's a brand. You know, his hair. Just him in general, like without even saying a word, he's just.
That was an afro with nobody.
Exactly, like, nobody like he's just. I'm like, yo, he's such a star. He's like, really like a rock star, a drummer rock star. You know.
It's interesting because you say he's not particularly social in that way, but yet he
everybody like he knows is, he's like just
it feels
yeah
accessible to everybody. I want to show you something real quick. We're gonna walk up. We were digging through the.
Shout out to Questlove, man, legend.
We were digging through storage when we moved over here and found this photo.
It's crazy, yep.
From the Philadelphia experiment.
Yeah.
I don't know. Can we?
The fro.
We'll do it like that.
Fear the fro.
Hopefully that comes out. Anyway, from the business side, he had an interview. It's got to be at least 2004 or 2005, where he says that they built a scene, they built a network, they built something together where it wasn't any one particular artist. It was I should be able to name all the people, but Jill's the only person that comes to mind. Jill and the Roots, obviously, only people that come to mind right now. But there were a bunch of different people on the scene, and they were all trying to work, and nobody was competing, so they were collaborating.
You say Jill. Erica Badu, Common.
Erica, Common, wow. Right?
You know, like people, Most Def, you know, just, yeah. Because I remember they had some photo shoots and different stuff. And just sitting back, watching all of that, and just being around it. James Porter, he's like, just sitting back and going to their studio, listening to this and that, watching them, just meeting random people. I came in there one day, and, you know, James was like, hey, Spank, you know, I want you to meet somebody. This is Jay Dilla.
Wow.
I'm like, oh my God. You know, this is like when we first started working a long time ago. It's just crazy, 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 crazy.
So everybody, I mean, well, Amir's kind of got that, he's the most recognizable face. I mean, you mentioned James Poyser, like,
mm-hmm.
Isn't that the engine?
Yeah, he's the engine.
Like behind the whole thing?
Yeah.
I mean, at least, I don't know, but
he's every the musician guru, I meet says he's that. Man, just... James, man, such an amazing producer, and you know, he's like family, showing me the ropes.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
So he came up in
he
that.
He produced our first record with Ty Tribbett. Cause you know, I did the first two or three records for Ty, and he produced the first one, Life. I think it went gold.
Nice. I'm supposed to know that, but
yeah.
And so maybe James, I did, but yeah. Now you reminded me.
James took our sound, and he, you know.
Wow.
I'll put it together, yeah.
Ty Tribbett's from Camden, New Jersey, is that right?
Camden.
Which is East Philadelphia.
Yeah.
For the record.
East Philadelphia. Yeah, it is, right.
More East Philadelphia than what I call East Philadelphia right now, because it's a little closer in, but, you know, on this side of the river. I grew up in the area, and you know, Camden was a place that I hung out when I was a kid, so when you hear somebody's from Camden, New Jersey, and they're successful and they made it on a national stage, you're like, wait, what?
Right.
It's crazy. It's a very challenging place to be and grow up. But I was in I took my kids skiing one time, and I didn't know who Ty Tribbett was. And we're at the Split Rock Lodge. Do you know about this place? It's like one of those old school Poconos resorts. You know, you can almost see like the old Jewish comedian performing in the lobby kind of feel. Like, okay. It's old, right? So, and it's just filled with people. And it's filled with church people, you know? And I'm in the elevator. Elevator doors close. And there's a guy next to me. And I'm like, hey, you know, how you doing? See you. And he seems very, very composed.
Yeah.
Very important. Elevator doors open and there's like 100 people just freaking out. Like it's, and I didn't figure it out till later. I had to look at the placard or the billboard. It was Ty Tribbett.
Oh, like, wow.
You know, I'm like, okay, now I know. Just be more prepared next time.
Yeah, man, it's definitely, that's family, you know, family. I'm so happy for them and all his success.
Do you want to talk about a little bit about how, about church and secular, the market, and like how and what that that's like for somebody? Do you want to go there, or do you want to?
I mean, I mean, people are gonna always, you know, have their opinions as far as church people. I mean, they're gonna have their opinions as far as, you know, you being a musician and playing different kinds of music and venturing out and this and that. And for me, it's not even venturing out. It's just being a musician, you know? I'm a musician. I love music. And my parents kept me grounded, you know? Like, whenever I would, you know, get some ridicule or, like, you know, I would come home and just talk to them. And they would, hey, listen, you know, you're good, you know, whatever. And I would be good after that, after talking to my parents. So as long as you have some type of refuge, you know, or, like, people that you can talk to that can keep you grounded and level-headed, it shouldn't be a problem. But, I mean, you know, it's, you're not out there talking about death and killing people and this and that. You know, you're a musician, so there's nothing wrong with, you know,
you're expressing yourself.
Yeah. Especially if you want to be the best musician you can be. You know, you want to be versatile, well-rounded. So, hey, you know, do what you need to do. If not, then just focus on gospel and, you know, make a limited amount of money, because you're not going to make that much money in gospel music, and just be safe with that.
You can't make a living at it.
No.
Gospel music, basically, right?
But
you're kind of,
if you're working like every single weekend, you know, if you're like super, super, super busy, and you know, getting like max money, it could work. But you have to be touring like nonstop, though.
Right. I mean, you said one thing about like it's the creative expression. So I wonder when, you know, I see some of the stuff, and I don't really know anything about this, which is pretty typical. But I have an opinion, which is also typical. Or at least I'm interested. I don't particularly have an opinion. I'm trying to understand. So I see some things happening in social media today with people talking about it, and I get a sense that there are certain people inside the church community who are concerned about it. But my real question is, is it creative expression or is it a social change? Do you know what I mean? Like, for an artist, you mentioned wanting to express yourself creatively, and does gospel music just not allow the amount of creativity and expression that somebody somebody as talented as yourself wants to express, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I wonder how that weighs out.
It's like, for me personally, I just pretty much do what I want. It's like I just try to be aware of both sides. Because, you know, it's like, I'm not trying to do what I'm doing for church folk. I'm not really trying to do it for anybody. But, you know, I'm just, as long as it's received on both sides, you know? Like, you know what I'm saying? It could be, I don't have a problem with doing gospel songs, and you know, I will do some gospel stuff. Been talking to Kim Burrell and different other people.
Nice.
But just this particular album right now, I'm speaking a lot about relationships and hardships and, you know, love, this and that, you know, regular stuff. It's not, and now that I'm sitting here thinking, like, a good example is my brother PJ Morton. You know, father is a bishop, my dad is a pastor, and, you know, we come from that world, and but he's a musician. But his music is inspirational, it's good. You know, he sings about love, everything's positive, band is killing. So it's like, you know, he's going through the same thing, but he's been in it much longer than me, but.
I hear a voice coming out, and I'm really sorry to kind of like go into that difficult territory, but I think what attracts people from outside gospel music to gospel music is the unity and the beauty of it. And now I hear like the same people coming out and making music that speaks to that, to like everybody. Is one, you know, and so to me, looking at it from the outside, it's like the core of the beauty and the core of that the whole thing is wonderful. I mean, we had do you know the Campbell Brothers? Campbell Brothers are from Rochester, New York, Word of God Church. Pedal steel. They gave Robert Randolph his first pedal steel guitar. We put that record out back in probably 2003, 2004.
Oh, wow.
And they played at the World Cafe right when they first opened. And it was, I think, one of the like third show outside the church. And these guys were like 30 to 35 years old at the time.
Wow, I know.
And it was just, I mean, you know, just amazing.
Yeah.
You know, it's just the beauty of it. So I'll stop on that
line. I know
line.
It's crazy.
We'll leave that one at
pedal
that.
Steel.
So tell me about the record. What's happening? We got a record coming up.
Record, Circa 81. I was born June 28th, 1981. Cancer.
Nice.
So it's just, it's the birthing of my sound, my artistry, my movement, the wave. So it's also the birth of my clothing line, which is also Circa 81, same thing. My sound is very organic. It's atmospheric. It's not a lot of crazy musical changes and
right. You're not showing off what you can do.
Yeah,
you're,
it's not like that because
you're
putting
something together, right?
Yeah, right. I want to, you know, like I didn't want to record as if I'm playing live. So I wanted to record like a producer. You know, I produced my album. That's what I did. So it's like certain songs. You know, of course I'm doing my thing and opening up. It's just a different presentation. So when you hear the songs live, it'll be like, you know, much more like crazy. Anything could happen once we do them live. But the sound is so different.
You'll stretch out once you get there, but you're making songs.
Yeah.
Right now, is that right?
Yep, totally different. It's really kind of hard to talk about. It's weird.
Yeah.
But the sound is so new. It's just a different sound. It's a little trappy, alternative, it's experimental, even a bit random at times. And I love it. It's raw, edgy.
I've heard a couple of roughs. Yeah. I can't really, you know, I can just say new ground.
Yeah.
New territory, and yet.
I should have named the album
Hello
as well.
Yeah,
it's like I'm here. So it's, I'm excited.
And this is really a debut for you, right?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
There you go.
The debut.
Awesome.
And awesome. It's it's more than just the release of that. It's more than just like a release. It's like the fresh new start, new way of life, new like mindset as far as like a new channel. You know, at first I'm a musician, I'm a drummer, and I'm gigging, and I'm going to start doing some gigs on the side. But no, I'm an artist. First and foremost, you know, and then it's like, okay, yeah, I do some gigs on the side too here and there. So just the attention and the amount of brainstorming that I do, and you know how focused I am on this is, you know, it's crazy, and I'm so excited about it. You know, I think about all types of stuff every single day, even down to my merch stand, how I want to set up and everything. So you know, it's really exciting.
You want to talk about the clothing? So we've talked about this a little bit. So, you know, I mean, and it's a common thing because I got into this game from or game this business from clothing.
Right.
So we've talked about it, and it's such an important. I like the parallel of music and fashion. Mm-hmm. For me, it's like, get up in the morning, what am I going to wear? It's such a core thing.
Exactly.
And what rhythm do I feel is such a core thing. So they're both really right down there. So
that's,
tell me about the clothing line.
My clothing line has been another major, major dream of mine, just like my album. Right now I'm starting with a small capsule with some t-shirts, a couple of sweatshirts.
Small capsule.
Like capsule meaning like... 6 or 7 pieces, you know. Like,
okay.
And then joggers, a couple of jackets, a couple of sweatshirts, and going to release that, kill the game with that, along with some accessories from Goodwood. And Goodwood has a box that you you sit your phone on top of the box and it plays your music, you know.
Yeah. Seriously?
Yeah, so it's a lot of things that we're doing.
Does it have to be an iPhone?
Yeah, does it? No.
No?
No,
any phone?
Just any phone, yep. And a lot of different accessories, and we're going to come out, kill the game with that, get the clothing line out there, and then like release the next capsule. So my album release will actually be a fashion show / like concert at the same time. So
amazing.
Yeah, it's going to be really dope. And then I'm going to do that pretty much everywhere. You know, it's going to be a pop-up tour, and I'm doing...
Sorry to interrupt, but where did the clothing thing come in for you? Like the fashion thing for you?
I've always been into fashion for so long, and once I went on tour with Kanye, and I really, 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 really got into it more then, but it was like more so the street, urban side. And then
because of Kanye?
Yeah, because I had a conversation with him, because at the time he was working on Pastel. He was working on his clothing line. And I didn't see any pieces, but I had a conversation with him, and you know, he was just talking about, you know, his own clothing line and different things he wanted to do. And I saw some things online, but you know, he was just saying, you know, he was really, really excited about it, and you know, it's coming out soon. You know, he's gonna, you know, hook me up with some stuff, whatever. And that made me just think about it, like, wow, because whatever Yeezy was rocking, I wanted to be like, man, that's dope. I need to get some of those. Oh man, that's dope. Right. I need to get some of those. So right. I was just automatically engage with it. And then after that, you know, I was just like, well, look, man, I want to do my own. And one of my cousins, he's been in the game for quite some time now, and he's been, you know, he's been developing clothing lines, and you know, he helped do mine, and it's going down.
Nice.
I'm excited about that. Yeah,
so we're gonna sync up the dates to be determined. Yep. To be announced, I should say. Don't Terrace Martin was on last week, he did a drop for us, and he said, pay attention to Ropeadope, because everything moves fast, and if you're not paying attention, you might miss some hip shit. I'm going to quote him on that, because this is the hip shit that you might miss if you're not paying attention. So
absolutely.
All right, we'll get those dates out to people. Do you want to... We don't have anything that we can share right now, right? Just yet? You're still in it, still stirring up the pot, or do you want to talk about that rock and roll...
Well,
the rock and roll band that you're in.
Yeah, I have...
That is fascinating to me.
Right, I have a rock band that I'm in called Knives. We, The Band Knives. Follow us on Twitter, The Band Knives, and on Instagram. And we just released a couple of songs. One song is called Give Me Air. It's on iTunes and SoundCloud. And we just released another one on SoundCloud called Wildin' Inside. So that right there is another
wave. Philly guys?
Nope. Toronto, LA, and Philly.
Nice.
So it was like a little triangle, but you know, a little bit of an isosceles triangle going on. But that's one of the things you said. It's getting to the point where, regardless of where your friends are from, it's getting to the point where, hey, look, we have to make it happen. So are you moving to LA soon? Okay, cool. I need to come near for a couple of weeks. Okay, cool. Because it's at that point where it's like, okay, let's start relying on a gig to get us together and this and that, but let's really, really step out and do it. Mm-hmm. So this is like step A, you know, of like stepping out. You know, the album is done and we're just, you know, releasing tracks here and there. And that's, you know, another project of mine. I just want to consume myself in these site projects that are going to make me a better musician, and that's, you know, really, really helping the whole underground scene as a whole.
Well, that's beautiful. And what's fascinating to me is like you're You're a badass drummer.
Thank you, Luke.
Pop, jazz, but rock.
Yeah, we.
You just played me something, and I was like, yeah.
I hate for people to try to put their finger, you know, on my playing. You know, I mean, of course, any black drummer that has chops, you know, they always say gospel chops, you know, and this and that. You know, I'm totally against that. You know, but I mean, I am from church, but that's the thing.
That's the starting point, right?
Yeah, that's the starting point.
The rest is.
But I just like to.
Oh, you are.
Yeah, I just like to show, improve versatility. You know, I'm big on that. Like, I love John Bonham. You know, I love Meg White. Meg White is one of my favorite drummers. She's so raw and nasty. You know, she may mess up, and I'm like, yeah, what's so cool? How did you do that? But you know, I don't know. Like, just I try to stay as raw as possible. And I don't know. Like, I don't think about being raw, but I just don't. I don't trip if you know if I do something that is not as clean as I wanted to be. I don't know. It's like just like.
That feel.
Yeah, it's like there's like 10% of freedom that I actually like because it keeps you raw instead of being so technical.
Mistakes.
Yeah.
Mistakes make us human.
Yeah.
That's why we're doing this.
Right.
And we don't know what it is, but just let it happen. Let it be real.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we can get away with a lot more than you can. You
right.
need to really know what you're doing.
Yeah, but, right.
You know.
Let me get it together.
That's awesome. Man, I just want to say thanks for trusting Ropeadope with your music. I'm really looking forward to what's coming.
Thank you.
In the future.
You guys are, you know, helping my dream come true. Ever since I told you, ever since I began touring and playing with anybody, my dad will always say, hey, listen, man, that's cool, but, like, when are you doing your own thing? Mm-hmm. All the time. So the fact that I'm releasing that, you know, like, you'll be there. You know, like, when I address the crowd, you'll see me. I'll be in tears because I know I'm going to be thinking about him. And it's definitely a new start, you know. Like, I'm making albums until my eyes bleed. Like, it's all I'm thinking about now.
Beautiful.
Ropeadope.
All right.